this time, I would like to ask Amanda to please call the roll.
Tucker Whitman?
Here.
Dan Vitale?
Present.
Mark Farah?
Present.
Paul Pinkney?
Here.
Joseph Runkle?
Present.
Keith Batman?
Here.
Hans Fetcher?
Here.
Terrence Baxter? Joseph Bennett?
Here.
Frank Reginelli?
Here.
Pat Mahoney?
Here.
Tim Lattimore?
Here.
Mike Didio?
Here.
Ryan Foley?
Here.
Michael Chapman?
Here.
Good evening. I'd like to call this special meeting of Auburn City Council to order. Today is Wednesday, May 14th, 2014. Mr. Mason, our clerk, will call the roll, please.
Councilor McCormick?
Here.
Councilor Camardo?
Here.
Councilor Cuddy?
Here.
Councilor Zika?
Here.
Mayor Quirk?
Here.
Would you please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance and remain standing for a moment of silent prayer? I would ask, as this is May, that we remember all the police officers in our country who have lost their life in the line of duty. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. As we begin this meeting, I just have a couple of words I'd like to share. One of them is welcome to our bodies and to all those that are present. This is another historic meeting. I hope this will be one of many that we enjoy and that there'll be some productive discussions. And I'm going to turn that with that over to Mayor Quill, who has a few remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to extend my appreciation to Chairman Chapman and the County Legislature for meeting with the City Council this evening. We are here tonight for a session I hope leads to more frequent formal, informal meetings between our two governments. I believe that we as elected officials of both the city and county share the same goal. That is to provide a safe, affordable community for our citizens, an attractive, prosperous business environment that creates jobs for our residents. That mission has become a huge challenge during the past decade as mandates pile up, service expectations increase, and revenues lag behind the cost of providing basic government services. Continuing to provide services and maintain public infrastructure is increasingly difficult. We're continually asking ourselves, how do we squeeze more out of every dollar? Do we cut quality of life programs in favor of public safety? Do we defer maintenance of infrastructure knowing we will pay more in the long run, maybe now or maybe later? Do we raise taxes and fees to preserve services at risk of causing people and businesses to move out of the area, furthering our economic woes? Much emphasis has been placed by the state on sharing services or consolidating functions among local governments as a way to create financial, sustainable communities. Governor Cuomo's new tax freeze proposal targets total tax levy reductions of 3% in the next 5 years, based entirely on a model of shared services and consolidated governments with no specific mandate, relief, or additional financial support from the state. At a recent work session, keynote speaker Mildred Warner from Cornell University presented research that shows that shared services arrangements are very likely to improve government services, but less than half the time do they result in tangible cost reductions. Still, we owe our citizens a good hard look at more economical ways to work together. We've had some successes in formal sharing or merger efforts, and the staff of the city and county regularly work together on an informal basis to solve problems and share resources on a project-by-project basis. We can build on these successes. In the interest of time, we have tried to keep tonight's agenda limited to only a few topics, but I hope we conclude this evening with some action items to include scheduling future meetings between our two governing bodies. As our citizens watch these proceedings, I hope we send a message out of our intent as elected officials to work together, regardless of political affiliation, for the greater good of all of our citizens.
Thank you, Mayor Quill. I just want to set a couple of rules of the road, if you will, topics. Mayor Quill and I will try to alternate in calling upon various members of each respective body and try to keep things moving. So without further ado, everyone has an agenda, and the first item on the agenda was the feasibility study for a city county. They were right here on the table, Peter and Amen. Feasibility study for a city county regional public works facility. And on April 30th, George Weffey, Mike Talbot, Suzanne Sinclair, administrator, Doug Selby, city manager, and I, and Tucker Whitman, who's chair of our public works committee, did take tours of both facilities. So before we go to legislative comments or questions, I would defer to Suzanne and Doug if you have any observations you'd like to share. Thank you.
Well, the objective of the tour was kind of thinking that before you can choose a direction, you have to know where you are. And so what we did was we toured the city's public works facility and the county's public works facility to just kind of get a feel for what resources they had, what were the pros and cons of each facility, what were the possibilities for co-location.
I think what we observed was a lot of similarities between what we do in the city and what the county does. Similar makes and models of heavy equipment, similar training requirements, and a lot of things that are in common that we think are great opportunities to start working together.
Okay, thanks. How about George and Mike, do you have any comments at this time that you'd like to share with our group?
I'd like to say something. I thought...
Come on up to the end of the table there, Mike, if you would. Microphone right
here. Here's George. For those of you who don't know, my name's Blake Talbot. I work for the city of Auburn. And the tour I thought went pretty well. Appreciative that it was arranged. George and I talk pretty routinely throughout the year on different things. And, you know, I think he's a very similar personality type as me, and it's funny because, you know, the more we talk, you know, as we work more closely together, kind of the same issues that I have, it's the same issues that he has, whether it's staff related, equipment related, weather related, and I thought that was kind of interesting for our day together, for half day together that we walked around. I know, you know, we talk pretty regularly, George and I, and you know, whether it's, like I said, staff-related or equipment-related, there's a common theme, and I know I was surprised at probably the condition, for lack of a better word, of your facility, which is similar to ours, which is really showing its age. And I guess to answer your question, Chairman, yes, I think there's definitely some possibilities between our two groups, and you know, really eager to see how we can work more closely together. You know, defer to George for some comments also.
Currently, I was going to say, fuel systems are being shared, or basically the city is utilizing the tanks and fuel distribution for gasoline and diesel fuel at the county, which again, I think is, especially as your system needed replacing, definitely a positive step. Why, like you said, maintain two of them. Like you said, it definitely there parallels with same types of issues with coming up, whether it be training issues, labor issues, even lack of training facilities. It's kind of funny. And I mean, looking, both sites are approximately 5 acres, and like you said, I think at times they're probably short for room and both facilities, be it indoor storage and out. I was going to say informally, I was going to say probably we've been sharing services quite a bit back and forth. Like you said, it may not be noticed. I know that you've done painting for us with roads, striping and different sign things, and we have a hydraulic post bounder that I think gets utilized sometimes when you're trying to drive through thick pavement, things like that. I'm trying to think here. We've purchased millings that you've used that were surplus from your roads program to put on some of our rural roads for either base material or backup. So like you said, there's, I don't think it's been publicized, but there has been quite a bit, I think, going on that's been unnoticed. Thank you.
Mr. Didio?
Who picked your salary? So the first step would be the feasibility study, would you say?
We think so, because it's a fairly big decision and a big undertaking to try to do any kind of merger. And we also believe that there may be some state money available for such a study. So I think we need to really look at all the details, and I think that's best done with us working together on a joint study.
About how long would that take? Is there any time frame on that?
I think probably upwards of 6 months.
Anyone else?
Do we consider that co-location is a reasonable expectation, or is it potentially we can continue to have two, I'm going to say, separate facilities? It appears if we're going to be sharing equipment, co-location has its advantages.
That's true, and I don't think we've really thought through the permutations of what could happen. Each site has advantages today. So I think part of that study effort would be, say, is one site better than two? Maybe one site specializes in a particular area of public works activity, and the other is something else. Perhaps maintenance is done in one, and the other is a skating area for other activities.
With the governor's, in my mind, with the governor's push for consolidation of governments and trying to streamline all our operations, I would be optimistic that there should be some funding and some grants available for one, the feasibility study, and secondly, to execute the plan. I can't guarantee that. I don't work in Albany, I work here in Auburn, but I would be very optimistic that there should be something available that I think we should, if this turns out the way I'm getting the feeling that we want it to, that we should be pursuing that along with the feasibility study, even paying for the feasibility study.
Mr. Walker,
who's going to do that? What department? Our county planning department does some grant applications. Who will take the ball with that?
I will investigate who has, you know, the workload and capability and interest as well to follow up on that. Between the city and the county, I'm sure that we can find people who can do that more efficiently than either that or us.
And I talked to our grants person, who tends to think that a proposal for a regional facility may be viewed more favorably if it originates with the county government. So with our support to
I'd also say that I would certainly approach all our state elected officials and get them on board as to what we're doing, so they can, you know, help facilitate the process if need be.
I'd like to see that as a joint effort.
Yes.
from both the city and the county to buttonhole our elected representatives in Albany. That is what we need.
Mr. Benjamin?
What's the condition of the city's buildings? I know what ours are. It's pitiful.
Well, what happened the day we toured, it's very very similar. We have roofing issues, we have some infrastructure issues, we have lack of mechanic space, we have lack of, and this really prevented us this winter from, on the extremely cold evenings and mornings of start, we have no inside parking for our plows. So we go with heaters in the trucks that plug in, but still when it was 15 and 20 below, we really struggle, as we all know, with packs of diesel fuel in the winter. So, you know, I was always envious of the county driving down York Street to see that nice indoor parking. But to be honest with you, after I toured, I'm still envious, George, but he has similar issues. And I guess, you know, we have roofing needs, we have plumbing needs, we have storage needs, we have really no adequate staff locker rooms, no meeting rooms, anything like that. It, you know, it's an old car dealership, and it was modified back in the when they joined all the departments together, which was a good move. But I think we've kind of, it suits our needs, but it's really, it needs work. We haven't done any work to it since then. So to answer your question, storage, interior parking, mechanic space, some staff needs.
Is this going to be handled through the two administrators, Doug and Susan? Part of the thing is we need to understand what the assets are, the capabilities of the individuals, any specialties, such as CDLs, things like this, heavy equipment operators, to really fully understand what can be used in complementary fashion and what needs to be perhaps shored up. Like I say, what I'm hearing about the buildings here, it seems like neither facility is capable of supporting a merged. So it almost says, unless we build a new building, that you really, the decision's already made that you'll have two separate facilities. However, again, to your point, to have one set building dedicated to certain functions and another to alternate functions, with any equipment needs at those locations, and should there be any need for equipment sharing, that it would have to be trailered, obviously. So what is your, I'm gonna say, obviously you had a very little time to think about this, but there should be some kind of tentative formulated plan here, at least at this point.
Well, I think when you look at the facilities, what you would find is that the facilities were once quite adequate, but that equipment has become bigger and more powerful as time's gone on, and the size is just simply not there. As for understanding what the pros, cons, issues are, what the advantages, I would see that as part of the outcome of the feasibility study to help us understand. Neither Doug has not told me about his engineering degree, if he has one. And I certainly don't. So I think that we need to look for experts in the field, and they will hopefully inform us on it.
I'd like to suggest that we ask Suzanne and Doug to get started on this project with everything, and initially everything on the table. And I would also like the council's blessing to, if Mr. Selby feels and Suzanne feels so, the desire to have at least two members of council to sit in with them. And that would be their choice whether they want them or not. If we go more than two members of council, we're not allowed by state law to do that, because there would be a majority of council, so two members. But I would leave that up with your permission. Suzanne and Doug, I'd like to leave it up to them.
I'm not going to disagree with you. I'm not sure adding more bodies at this moment is going to accelerate the project. Maybe one person from council, one person from our legislative body. And also, I would like you and I to maybe construct the letters and get them out, and then follow up with phone calls to our elected that this is our plan.
Would you like to? That's fine. I just want them to have the opportunity, if they feel that Councilor Zeke is better suited in one area versus Councilor Camardo, and he may have another strong point. That's my thought in that regard. Do you want to do a joint letter, or do you want to do separately from each other? And that can be ironed out.
We'll do a joint. Anyone else?
Can we put a time frame on it?
I would say we could give you a progress report in 2 months.
How many?
2 months.
2 months? 60 days. As long as it doesn't get lost in the
I think the beginning point is to understand what the assets are, what equipment's out there. Obviously, Doug, I don't think you know every piece of equipment the county has, and I'm sure, Susan, you don't know every piece of the equipment the city has. Nor do you have an idea of what the personnel's qualifications are. Again, the CDL is a heavy equipment operation, this type of thing. I think that's the beginning point, because now you're going to have a better feeling for what the pool is, what the population is. So that should be probably the one of the first few steps, I would think.
Mr. Batman.
As I understand the charge, and that's one thing I want to be clear on, but as I understand the charge, what the charging is to look at the a feasibility study, look at the possibility of getting support for a larger feasibility study. Is that correct?
Yes.
This is fairly time sensitive. If there is money available, it will be competitive money. And so I would suggest, all due respect, to 60 days simply too long. I don't think, and I respectfully disagree, that it's necessary for y'all to get an inventory of equipment. I think that's part of the feasibility look. And what we're looking for is to see ways that we can collaborate, things that make sense. Part of that will be, I'm sure, collecting the an inventory and other things. But I would rather see us move quickly to get to the point where we're applying for support to do a more formal feasibility study. It just seems to me to make more sense. If we wait too long, then what will happen is the funds will be gone if they're available, and we will simply be facing a big bill.
Christine Selder.
The county and the city are huddling.
That's good.
They've started working already.
Christina? We understand you and Mr. Lynch are collaborating. Are you aware of any timetable from the state in regards to the grants we're discussing here?
June 16th, so it is about 5 weeks away.
That might be a deadline
for us. Christina, not to burden you anymore, but is it possible to write something that quickly? I'm not asking you, but is it possible or probable?
Possible.
Possible.
It would help. We will eventually need a resolution from both bodies within that 5 week period to authorize us to submit a grant application. I believe those funds are a 50-50 match. If the communities decide to move ahead with implementation of the recommendations, the state will actually reimburse some of the matching funds. So there's incentives there to try to move ahead with the recommendations that are outlined in the study.
Christina, can you share that information either with Mr. Lynch or send it over to one of us?
Sure, I'm happy to.
Thank you.
I would think that it should be no problem for us to have a draft resolution and walk it on tomorrow with this very idea.
I don't think you need to do that.
You don't need it that quickly.
We just need it before the deadline. What would be helpful is in the resolutions, the state likes to see how much funding we're asking for, how are we matching the funds, who's providing what type of staffing, you know, the goal of the project. So we should actually have a little bit of information in the resolution, not just saying, you know, because of these issues with our facilities, we're looking to do a feasibility
right as a grant together? Okay, great, excellent.
I think I need some clarification. My understanding is we're talking strictly about a joint facility, a possible joint facility. We're not talking about joining county and city highway departments, are we?
I don't think anybody's talking about joining departments, but our efforts would collaborate, and we would look for and find those efficiencies that are possible and utilize them. It may not even come back that you want one facility, but I think what we saw and what we've talked about, it makes sense that maybe there is a purpose for each location, or maybe it would be advantageous to put it all in one area.
Council McCormick, was your question answered, or?
Well, I do it, and now, I was just trying to help Terry out before. That's why I, it's a question on I guess how we get updated. I think the 60-day progress report probably is within range. It's the getting it action things that need to be done like this in advance. Are we going to ask for how would we get progress reports? Are we going to plan on meeting again, or do we all need to meet for this specific task? That's what I was wondering.
I would think the people that are involved could have a meeting, produce a document that could be distributed to each of us, gives us a chance to take a look, respond with any questions, and I think that would be the best way to expedite the process.
That would be the question. Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Mr. Bennett.
During the feasibility study, will we be looking at alternate sites? Because throughout the city and county, we have numerous manufacturing facilities that might accommodate all these. Will they be looked in and taken into consideration?
I would anticipate that that's an option that would be explored. I mean, there are a number of facilities around. The question then will be, you know, what the cost would be, or estimated cost to make each one work.
Yes, I just, first of all, thank you for being with us tonight and sharing some ideas. As revenues shrink, unfortunately, we have to think about smarter ways of doing things. We can't keep turning to taxpayer because the taxpayers are taxed enough as it is, but I'd like to see us take a different approach. Sometimes I have a problem with how many studies we do, because I can take you to City Hall and on the second floor, we're loaded with studies that we've done over the years, and studies to do the study to do the study, unfortunately. I'd like to empower our department heads to come to both bodies and show us some cost savings on how they think that they can save the duplication services. I talked to the sheriff today. I'd like to talk to the police chief, have both of them come together, share ideas about cost savings. We have an assessor. This county has a real property department to talk together about combining services. We have DPW and a highway garage. We have a city clerk and a county clerk, duplication of services. We have a city planning board and a county planning board. We have legal services on both ends of the aspect. These are the areas that I think we need to concentrate on, how we empower our department heads to come back to us to look at cost savings before we get into looking for major studies that I don't know if these major studies are going to have much of a result in the long run. So I think we need to start with our department heads, empower them, they're the professionals, and start coming back to us with some cost savings, with some areas that duplication is costing both entities a lot of money, and how we can come together to provide those services, because we're going to be forced to start working together. It's not going to be an option as money dries up, unfortunately, in the area. So I just wanted to talk about that and see if we could start working with our department heads to bring cost savings to the table.
Thanks, John. I think certainly we expect the department heads to be involved in this group and taking a look at the operations. Mr. Foley.
This is one area that we've already kind of studied, and we realize that we can accomplish through baby steps, working with the city and the county,
we both need new garages, or, so this is one area where we have kind of already seen that we have a possibility to work together. We just need to get a feasibility study done to make sure that it's possible to do so, and we can save money now with this, and maybe what Mr. Camardo was talking about, something more long term. But right now, I think, you know, what we have right here is what I can go with.
Thank you. Anyone else have any comments or questions with regard to this topic? Mr. Dale.
Just wondering here if we can take what Mr. Camardo was saying and do a parallel move with doing the feasibility study, and at the same time we have different department heads meeting possibly to accomplish a part of what Mr. Camardo is saying. Or proposing.
Yes.
Pardon me?
Or proposing.
Sure. And I would ask, look to Suzanne and Doug, when you speak to the various departments, make that strong suggestion and get the conversation started.
In all departments.
In all departments.
In all
departments. Yes, in all departments.
In all departments.
Anybody else?
Next item on our agenda is merging the city and the county power agencies. I'll start off very briefly. We both have a power authority, a municipal power authority. They seem to be commingled, that members of one are on the other or vice versa. It takes up staff time, takes away from a lot of other activities that we should be completing, so our suggestion, my suggestion, is we try to bring the two of them together, working for, they work, the city works for itself right now for the city, but I think it should be all for one entire, for the entire county, not segregated into the city and the county. So I'd like to see the, if we could find a way to merge these two committees.
Anybody have any thoughts? Mr. Pittman?
I have one. I sit on the Caboose board, and I guess I wouldn't have a problem sitting down with both parties and having an initial conversation. But I find it very difficult at times with the layer of government that we have to go through overseeing, you know, our entity. And unless somebody's going to totally let go of their entities and representation combining, I find it very hard because we're going to have two governing bodies, one more layer of government to work with. So I feel a lot of frustration coming with that, but I'd be open-minded in the first conversation to sit down and see what people have to say.
I agree with you. At the same time, the power authority for the city of Auburn is an advisory group to the city council. I totally agree with you. It should be serving all governments within the county, not slaves to the city nor the county. It should be an entire working group for everyone. So I agree with you. And how we get from point A to point B, I would look to Doug and Suzanne to help us get through that. It's going to settle a lot of work on them this evening.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Lattimore.
As chairman of the County Power Authority, let me just say I'm all in favor of merging and consolidating. And I think when I was on the city council back in 87 to 91, in 91, part of my re-election campaign was to have a metropolitan system between the city and the towns, and that would be fire, police, sewer, and water. I didn't get re-elected. I think that was probably part of the reason for it. What I stated in there was that whatever we do, that it's going to be a while. Back then I said that if you had a job with the city, you could continue that job because there would be a sunset date 20 years up.
And I think I instructed then Fireman, or Fire Chief Quill to go to the town of Owasco and see whether or not we could sell some of our services to the surrounding towns. In regards to trying to put the two power companies together, I think that they're both under referendums by the public. And I think it would take a referendum to seize one. And I'm just concerned about the city's politics over the years with power agencies been difficult at best. And I wouldn't want to merge them at this time to complicate things. I think I stood up in front of council one night and asked, I was giving a little review, I was on the agenda, and what I wanted to do was put a solar project down at the city landfill, which is 50 acres, and I was told I was out of order. So I see the difficulty in trying to work in the city. I'd rather work with the towns. But.
And Mr. Lattimore, as you recall, or you may recall, the city is still part of the county, and we feel we're a big part of the county. At the same time, I think your time frame is a little bit off in regards to 87 to 91, but that's neither here nor there. We have to look at this as a community, not as a city, not as a county. We need to look at it as a community. What's good for me is good for my neighbors in Aurelius or Senate or True. And I think by combining these services, we can accomplish that. And I also disagree that we need a referendum to unregister our power authority, for lack of better words. I disagree with you on that, but this isn't the first time we've disagreed, but we smile and walk away.
Anyone else? Mr. Petcher?
City.
Mr. Petcher?
Does the city power authority, or whatever it is, you just said it's an advisory group, does it have any powers?
It does not.
So it's just strictly an advisory group?
Exactly.
Thank you.
Would you please state your name for the benefit of the clerk?
Yeah, my name is Dennis Zack, and I'm chair of the Auburn Municipal Power Agency. The best part of a year ago, we actually voted to try to do some joint meetings, and that was a unanimous vote, and, you know, at our city meeting anyway. And I think that would be the best way to attack it. One of the problems is, and probably was my fault, but the schedule of the booster board meets at 9 o'clock in the morning, and we meet at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I think in order to have a few joint meetings to see, number one, and see how the structure, because right now I don't think either agency is totally aware of what's going on either side of the fence. There are two members on both boards, so we're already cross-tied. You know, on the city agency, Mayor Quill and Councilor Zinka both sat on the agency also, but I'd like to try and say let's see if we can have a couple of joint meetings. We can both open up or whatever. We've done it between the county and the soil and water stuff before. I think it might be worth a shot to see if we can both get on the same page and see what kind of a structure it would take to redo it before we get into any legal stuff. So I don't see any reason why we couldn't have some joint meetings. We just got to come up with a time structure that works for both of us.
Thank you, Dennis. Suzanne or Doug, do you have any comments on this subject?
Mr. Zack and I have talked, and I know he's made efforts to have these joint meetings. I think that is a good start, because we need to share information and then maybe together propose what a new agency would look like, what kind of authorities it would have, what kind of support it might need, what kind of objectives it might be charged with accomplishing.
I guess I'm a little bit confused about the issue. If we're discussing the joint meetings, then those are just joint meetings, and they can be done, and that is a good way to encourage communication. If we're discussing, though, attempting to coordinate, consolidate, and move forward as one agency, then that's not a joint meeting. that's a new form, a new board. And in terms of this county-city thing, you know, one of the things I would ask is, does the city have a board of health?
No.
Are there other boards that the county has that the city doesn't have? I think my point is I think the answer is yes. my point is that the fact that there's currently now a city board and a county board may or may not make sense. And that's the issue. What we ought to look at is does it make sense to combine these? And I think that's the charge. I think it makes perfect sense to get the input from the existing boards. But the idea is not to come up with a form for communication. That's what this is. And we're not talking about combining. Well, I don't think we are. Are you all talking about dissolving and becoming part of the county? Okay, I didn't think so. I just want to make sure.
I thought it was going to be the other way.
But, you know, it's a little different focus, and that would be my concern, that we be clear on what the focus is. Nothing may come of it, but the focus needs to be clear. It's not communication. It's talking about better ways to do things.
Councilor Cutting.
I agree with Legislator Batman about a little having this discussion be a little have a little bit more weight than just joint meetings, and again, obviously, that would be determined by Suzanne and Doug, but especially with the input of Denny and the Capusa, the chair of Capusa. So joint meetings are good, but I think that this meeting today is trying to see where there's already some overlapping that we can actually consolidate and show both the taxpayers and the state in general that we are really working together with some substantial consolidation and coordination.
Anyone else?
Maybe just have one question. Getting back to the referendum. It took a referendum to create the power of authority.
No.
It
did not. Power of authority was created by local law. The referendum was passed to raise the limit for the monetary amount that the city could devote to a power type of development or facility. So it doesn't take a referendum to dissolve the city agency, it takes a local law.
Okay. Regardless, I think the first step in anything here is that these two entities need to get together, sit across the same table, and begin this discussion as just the starting point. Really think, because like I said, Denny has some certain expertise, John Montone has expertise, and I'm sure the county has some expertise. Out of this pool of expertise, we should be able to figure out what best would make up a new agency should we choose that direction. But again, until you have those first initial sit downs and they basically talk about what it would look like and how it would perform, it'll never start. So I think that is an initial beginning point, not that it's the final end of it, but I mean that is the initial start.
Anyone else?
I think we have to keep in mind that what we have on the agenda in front of us are a package of seeds. And we want to consider whether or not we want to try and plant these seeds and grow these seeds and have perhaps something different occur that will produce efficiencies for both sides of our groups. Anyone else have any questions, or can I have a video?
I'd like to see movement towards that joint meeting, but also a time frame. There's some type of progress report. I don't know the time frame. Maybe a little more than 2 weeks, but not any longer than 6 months. We get lost in the beginning. Does anyone want to commit to that?
just a point of clarification. You said that the Auburn Power Authority is an advisory to the city council. And Kapusa.
Yes. All the authority and actions of the Auburn Team Power Agency must be approved by the city council. It's at the consent of and approval of the city council.
And what is Kapusa's standing as far as county approval?
Mr. Westfall.
Thank you. Kapusa is a standalone agency which was created by a referendum. So it would take a referendum to modify or amend it. There are certain reporting requirements such as bonding that would have to go to the county legislature.
So if everything was put into Kapusa, they can take on any project in the county?
Theoretically, yes.
Okay.
Subject to a referendum.
Okay. So we basically have to determine, if we want to look at consolidation, what a new board would look like?
Pat, could you repeat that question? We couldn't hear you.
Just clarification that Kapusa could take on any energy project in the county, including the city of Auburn.
I would want to check that. Theoretically, yes.
So, looking at consolidation, it seems to me that we do have the mechanism in place, we have the agency in place that can take on everything within the city and county. I think that the real discussion needs to be the membership of that board and the makeup of that board, not so much anything more than that. So I think sometimes we get stuck in the mud on trying to rehash and recreate everything when it's just kind of looking at the current membership and how do we get representation that everybody can live with and allow them to go out and do those projects.
I have a little difficulty because I don't totally understand that. What are the economics of merging these two organizations?
None.
Okay.
To best of my knowledge, other than staff, it's all volunteer. To best of my knowledge,
right.
I know the Power Authority in the city of Auburn has no budget, nothing. I cannot speak for the county, so it's a zero.
Both agencies are staff.
Yeah, it's staff time that's involved, which would be, depending on the meeting, I'm sure at times with the, if they were to combine, city staff may be involved as well as county staff, depending on the project, depending on the meeting. Council McCormick.
Going off Mr. Mahonick's point, which sounds reasonable, to put it that way, then it's really, following up on Mr. Mahonick's point, that makes sense that you're just looking at who should be on the county advisor. Is it an agency or an authority, the county power?
Authority.
Ours is an agency, is that correct? That makes the difference, I think.
Sure.
It is a difference.
Makes a difference in the origination or the empowerment,
right,
of creating these entities.
Okay. If the question is just who should serve on the county authority.
Well, I don't mean to interrupt you.
That's okay. That's fine.
But I think the question is, and I don't know, the referendum that the county passed or established this authority, whether or not that again would obligate the city or give them authority to do projects within the city, even though the city is part of the county. It depends. I don't know what the language is, and Fred and I certainly could look at it.
Mm-hmm. Well, that wasn't even my question, but thank
okay.
you. But my question was that, if, to our point, as far as the city goes, we're still left with people on the power agency. So that agency, would we be talking about not necessarily combining them, but dissolving one while the other one becomes more of a representation?
Yes.
So
yes.
I just want to be clear that that's what we're talking about, if that's what we're talking about.
Mr. Westfall?
Picking up on John's comments, if the flavor of the two bodies is to move forward with one type of entity to function in both the city city and county. If that's what the understanding is, then I would offer to work with John, and we would figure out a way to make that happen. I don't know if today's the day to get too much in the weeds, as was said earlier today. But if the concept is there, I'm sure John and I could work through with the other technocrats and figure out a way to make it work.
Mr. Petrow?
You've been asking the reason.
Okay. Mr. Lynch, did you have something you'd like to add?
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve Lynch, and my staff and myself provide the staff for the County Power Agency. I just want to clarify on the one point with regard to the economics of the Power Agency. While it's true that there are no budgets right now for the County Power Agency established, there's only so far these agencies, even with the dedicated staff and with the expertise that's on those boards, that they can take projects, because these types of projects require legal and technical expertise that's beyond the scope of the county staff. And if they're going to engage in projects, they need funding behind those agencies in order to execute on those projects. So I just want the boards to be aware that you can have these power agencies, but they are to some extent static unless they're funded. And so I think that that needs to be kept in line. And one more point is, my understanding from reading the enabling legislation that created the county agency, it exists right now. It can do projects throughout the extent of the county, including the city of Auburn. But everybody has to keep in mind, when you do a project, you have to have the agreement and the buy-in of many different parties, including landowners, and that could be city council, utilities, other agencies. So while there is authority for the County Power Agency to execute projects throughout the county, there has to be the cooperation, the willingness of all the parties that are engaged in any particular project.
Thank you, Steve. Anyone else have any questions, comments? Mr. Mahoney.
Just the funding apparatus that Steve talked about, I think myself, I would be more likely to be in favor of funding if we were in a position where we were all working together instead of in competition with each other. You know, if the county is going to fund their agency with $50,000 and the city is going to do $20,000, we're going to be in direct competition where we can have one pool and work for the entire county, the city, outside, going to towns, all that stuff. I think if we can come up with one agency, that the possibility is much more likely to occur.
Thank you.
Could I make a suggestion that we ask Mr. Rossi, Mr. Westfall, to sit down and possibly get back within a couple weeks, if Legislator Didio had requested a time frame, to see if it's feasible, and following the same format basically as you did with the item number one, if you're in agreement.
Shortly after the decision is made, to the point, then we're going to have to decide how it's going to be funded. Being a joint venture, it should be somehow jointly funded. So, given the fact that we're all in the same budgetary constraints, we really have to understand to what level we can fund this and absolutely what level of investment we want to make here. Obviously, this will ultimately lead to some enhancements to the area, so we really have to be very open-minded about how much we choose to invest in this effort.
Anyone else? Okay, item number three is regarding combining the civil service offices. Suzanne or Doug, do you have anything to offer on that point?
Well, we both have civil service commissions. I think both of our commissions deal largely with the same kind of issues under the same set of rules. It is embedded in our city charter, so this is one that would require a referendum for of elimination of the city civil service commission.
And how many people do you have in your civil service office presently?
Less than one.
Oh, I see that. Mr. Russell, how many people do we have?
We have five.
We have five. Anybody have any thoughts or questions?
Yes, as we both know, both the county and the city both have commissions. And one way of accomplishing this is if the city of Auburn kept their commission and the county was to take over administrative duties, functions of the civil service office. And then you would have your own commissions, the county would have theirs, and of course the city would have theirs working with the county for administrative support. But it does need a referendum by the taxpayers to change the city charter, so that would have to happen. So the only option, if that didn't happen, would be to merge the administrative duties of those offices.
Which would eliminate the referendum, or it would go hand in hand?
No, you wouldn't need a referendum if you combine the administrative duties of both offices and retain the respective commissions, the city commission and the county commission. So they would hold those duties.
Council McCormick.
This is another one of those I think that we need to look at all the details of, as far as the cost savings, which I think isn't a great deal, but I think there's a cost savings to an entity that's not here, the school district, which would be good for the school district, which we're all a part of anyway. I'm not sure if that would be, of keeping two commissions is a good idea. It kind of defeats the purpose of consolidating and saving, because I'm not sure what right now, the way it works in the city anyway, the commission, the office staff works for the commission, and they direct what's going on. So I don't know how that would work. The logistics of it all, I think it's worth looking at with an open mind, thinking of everything that potentially could be combined. I think it's a great example of something Councilor Camardo mentioned, two different entities with two similar offices, how can we combine them and make the best of it? And I think we don't have a human resource department. There's a lot of things we don't have for the city that I think, not that I'm trying to move into your civil service area, but there's a lot of economies and benefits, so I think it's worth looking at.
On this topic in particular, do we know who else has done this?
The only thing I'm aware of is that in Seneca County, there was the civil service covered the entire county. We had one civil service officer who dealt with that, so it worked well for Seneca County, but Seneca County is much more smaller, of course. So.
The way the governor has set up this tax relief, tax refunds, everything for the next few years is going to be examined. This may not be the most profitable way to go about it or with the power authority, but it's showing good faith on both the city and county's part that we're working towards consolidation. We may very well find out, or the voters may tell us, that they do not want to merge both of them. But in all honesty, I feel we should give it a fair look at it, a good look at it, to see if it is possible, feasible, what the good parts and what the bad parts are, and move forward from there.
Anyone else have any questions, comments, concerns? Mr. Brennan.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I've been informed by a couple guests here that Cortland County does have just one commission, and they take care of all the towns, villages, and everything down in there.
Thank you. Anyone else?
So if we agree as a group to move forward on this, how would we see that starting?
Rossi and Mr. Westfall to look into this and get back to Mr. Selby and Suzanne. Just keep moving along and see what has to, my suggestion, what has to be done and how we would do it. And the referendum is also timely also. We have an election coming up in November. There's a time clock working backwards as to when we would have to request this referendum.
the agenda here is for CETA's role as a one-stop economic development agency, entity. I'm not sure what I should call it, but it makes a lot of sense to, you know, we have people who are prospecting this region and have one focal point where they can get this information and one time, one location. Andrew, if you want to say something, please come on over and grab the mic.
Sure. Good evening, I'm Andrew Fish, Executive Director for the Cayuga Economic Development Agency. You know, I think we have been talking about this for a while, about economic development as a one-stop. And, you know, I look at a year and a month ago, we had entered into the first contract with the county for doing economic development services as a one-stop. And a year and a month later, we are several months into, almost half a year into providing administrative services to the Cayuga County IDA, and the Auburn IDA passed a resolution to authorize a contract to begin those administrative services as of June 1st. And we're performing the one-stop duties for the county as a whole, which includes the city of Auburn. So, you know, for all intents and purposes, as long as everyone is still looking to accomplish what we set out to accomplish a year and a month ago, I think we're moving in the right direction. I think that there are still a few more things that we can talk about that are still on the table, but I think some of the big ticket items are taken care of. We finally have all of our staff in place right now, the two new hires that we brought on, who are already drastically increasing the level of service that we can provide for businesses in Cayuga County, which is great. We're seeing that as a tangible result. One of the new hires is here tonight, Bruce Sherman. He's our economic development specialist. And then our business development specialist is Maureen Research. She started with us at the beginning of this week. So, you know, I think things are moving forward in a great way. I'd asked earlier about the purpose for this being on the agenda. And, you know, if it's nothing more than to say, hey, we have an example here of how we have been able to collaborate and have been able to consolidate some things and move forward in an efficient manner, I think this is one of them. So, you know, I'd certainly answer any questions that anyone has, but we're excited about being in our next full contract and beginning conversations about long-term contracts. And then also I know the conversations with the city around some of the administrative things that are tied up with the CDBG program that the planning department is still doing, that we've talked about, you know, bringing to the table for discussions, transferring some of those duties in terms of the loan programs and then prior zone reporting and some of those things sometime in the next few months. I mean, our timeline for that is not necessarily immediate, but we're willing to move as quickly on that as possible. So, you know, be happy to take any questions that anyone has.
One thing is a bit lacking is an information transfer. And I would encourage if we get some kind of reporting out of CETA that would either be disseminated to the bodies and perhaps even published in the newspaper. But it appears to me that all this should be job growth numbers, opportunities that are being investigated, activities as such, because right now, I could probably ask everybody here in the room and they couldn't tell me.
I disagree. I brought things to City Council from one of those meetings to show you what.
I understand, but that's to the City Council. I'm talking about everyone. The people need to know. This needs to be published. It needs to be out there that everyone can see what type of activity, because they've got a budget, they've got some level of accountability to the taxpayer. They need to have this out and do this reporting so that everyone knows. You can ask any taxpayer out there, what has CETA done? I bet you get a deer in the headlight book.
I wouldn't. Go ahead.
Peter, we did, as a matter of contract and our agreement, we do require that reporting, and that's brought back to the planning board and shared with the entire legislature regularly.
But that doesn't get out to everyone.
That's part of our agreement.
So, yeah, I mean, I guess, Peter, to come back to what your comments were there, or Councilor Zika, definitely we are working on promoting more of that. You know, there is a level of the activity that we carry out that is confidential in nature. I think you understand that. We have an annual report that we will have up on the website here shortly that's been distributed to the entire legislature. We do monthly activity reports
Right now, we are not a public agency like ACCIDA. We have a contract. We're not a public entity. We're not subject to public authorities and public the PAAA and that type of reporting level. And so, you know, because of that, it's not like we are opposed to putting those things up on our website. Anyone can come into our office and we'll share information that we can share. You know, we are a not-for-profit organization, so, you know, you can go on GuideStar, you can get our 990s, you can see all of that. And the activity reports that we share with the legislature and also with our board, I'm perfectly happy with sharing those on a regular basis. They go to the board, and of course, the mayor sits on the board by title, as well as the chairman of the IDA. They get those reports on a monthly basis, too. And, you know, as we move forward with the city in terms of contractual relationship with the city, I would be more than happy to talk about what reporting mechanisms would be there as a part of that. In terms of what activities we do and the public's perception of that, you know, we are more about promoting the services that are available than necessarily the activities that we're carrying out on a daily basis. We want people to know what's available, that they can come in and get those services. And so the promotion that we're going to be doing is going to be focusing more on here's what you can get, here's what you can receive when you come and get services from us. And it's a service that we provide to businesses in Cayuga County because of the relationship that we're in with the county.
What I would like to see then, that perhaps these same reports should be distributed to council as well, because I haven't seen one except with the exception of one that was brought back. So, I mean, the information would at least give some idea as to what level of activity it is, the return on the investment, and really what perhaps may need to be changed.
Understood. I would say that we can work certainly through the mayor who's on the board to get those reports back to council. As a board member, he can share those with you. And as I said before, if we enter into a contractual relationship, there would definitely be a mechanism of reporting that would be a part of that.
Anyone else? Question? Mr. Lattimore?
Andrew, with regards to manufacturing, is that one of the critical points that manufacturers look at is the energy cost in the area, and are we being able to supply a low-cost power to some people who are looking at us?
You know, energy is certainly on the top five of the pains for businesses in central New York, and low-cost power is an elusive thing. So I would say that if you look at our neighbors around us, we're competing on an even playing field. If you look at our neighbors in terms of states around us, we're not necessarily competing on an even playing field. So that necessarily isn't an issue just in Auburn and Cayuga County, but it's certainly something that if we can find innovative ways to deliver low-cost power, we can find solutions to you know, help people grow here.
Mr. Foley?
Yeah. I know that the CETA and the college are kind of working together for Start of New York implementation. Can you just tell us a few ways that maybe the city and the county can benefit mutually from that process, maybe work together on it?
So Start of New York is still a process that's being undertaken. We've submitted the plan, the Board of Trustees approved it, we submitted it to SUNY, we have not heard back. Once we hear back, then we have a 30-day period of public comment. Then once that's over, final changes are made and submitted once again for approval. So we're still, at best, a month and a half, 2 months away, could be longer before the plan is actually approved. You know, being strategic about what startup opportunities we pursue, and really that's ultimately the college's decision. Right now the way the plan is set up, the leads come through CETA and we bring them, we vet them and we bring them to the college. But making sure that as a community we're not having these opportunities compete with existing businesses, or that's at worst and slightly less advantageous is if they're stealing all the quality employees from existing businesses. Those are the things we need to be cognizant of and aware of as we move these startup opportunities forward. The benefit will come in the added jobs and the added expendable income in the community and the added investments by people moving here and having employment. And then at the end of that 10 years, hopefully we've done a good enough job of keeping that company engaged and growing them, so that once those benefits go away, they stay here and all of those tax implications come back to the municipalities as well.
Thank you. summation in regards to this meeting. It seems like, and I think we can all agree, that for as long as we can remember, whenever there's been an election in the city or the county, everybody's always said, I want to work together, we want to do things. I think the step one that we refer to this evening is for both the county and the city to make the statement that we want to work on consolidation, and then get out of the way. Let Doug and Suzanne get together, let them tackle these issues, bring the information back to us so we can analyze it, see if it's something we want to approve or not approve. Let them utilize the city staff and the county staff, and I think that's about the only way we're going to move forward and really make some significant changes and make the consolidation that we're all talking about.
Yeah, thank you. Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Lattimore.
I know it wasn't on the agenda tonight, but I think that you know, our pension cost, our health cost, and labor cost are big issues. And hopefully, with the, we have our advisor, the city's advisor, and the hospital's advisor is all First Niagara with Zach Zuckerman and Judy. I'd like to be able to put on this agenda whether we could work with some of our school districts to increase some of the numbers that we have that we're covering now under our consortium of health. And if we bump it up a little bit, I think it'd be advantageous to everybody's purchase of health insurance. And I think that's a soft cost that we can do pretty easy, and it's a big number. And I'd like to see more soft cost things like the treasurers getting together, sending out one tax bill versus two separate billings. I think that would be advantageous to both units. But I think the health purchase is number one. Since the hospital, the city, and the county all have the same advisor, I'd like to let them look into whether or not, if we increase some of the bodies, whether we can reduce everybody's per unit and per family cost.
I think it's a good topic for the future, and I think that the conversation with a health consortium, you know, would further that cost. Does anyone else have any other?
Just in the spirit of this, keeping the momentum, I know it was quite a number of months between the last meeting we had. I would like to see these have a little bit more frequency, perhaps a monthly or every 2 months. And I would like us to kind of agree on a time and a date to perhaps reconvene, continue the discussion so that this doesn't get stagnant.
I agree. What do you suggest here?
Well, I would suggest, again, I'd like it to be a decision that everyone else, but at least a 1 to 2 month time frame. I mean, do we meet every 2 months or every 1 month or whatever time you decide, but rather than languish for a good number of months and then basically having to pick up and you know, get the machine started again, I would like to try and continue us at least to maintain some level of momentum, and perhaps as need be, we may even increase or decrease the frequency as we so desire.
I would suggest that we meet in at least a couple of months, and in the meantime, we'll have to check our various meeting schedules, and we can circulate a date.
Yes.
And get agreement on that.
I'd like to make sure that Doug and Suzanne have some time to give us a report on something. I do agree with you more, but I don't want to rush into having a meeting and not have any meat to work on.
Well, I would think again the initial time frame, I guess maybe we could let it be the gatekeepers of the admins. But I do want to see this meeting a bit more frequently than what we have been. Like I say, that time frame it's been a languishing, almost ended, and now it's beginning again. It seems like it's the inertia of it all. I mean, we need to keep some level of motion and some level of inertia. Plus, as we go along here, it shows everyone that we're really making an effort and not just giving a lip service.
Okay.
Is everyone in agreement? Try for a meeting in a couple of months?
Yes.
That was good.
City Council.
That was good.
Anybody else have anything you'd like to bring in or do you?
Motion to go into executive session in regards to litigation.
Is there a second?
Second.
Chipotle second. All in favor?
Aye.
Let's hear that again. Let me just preface this. I know it was on the schedule, then it was taken off the schedule until the attorneys could talk, and apparently that didn't happen until very late. I promise this will not take 10 minutes of your time. Mr. Runkle, will there be other business?